We're gonna make the Thermacell pouch. We just released this last night. I don't think anybody even knows. It's on the website. Thermacell. This is a pouch that truly nobody even needs. You can put this anywhere, really. I think it comes with a pouch even. I think this even came with a pouch. But it's cool, and if you want a place to put your Thermacell for your mosquitoes, you just can put it right here and attach it to your gear. The sample pictures we took don't have it, but I'm actually gonna put loops here so that you can actually attach a shoulder strap if you want to and just carry it around your neck or under the side or whatever. You can buy these at Walmart, Amazon, wherever, Thermacells. And runs on a little fuel cell and has this little card that goes in front that puts out something that detracts mosquitoes. I don't know if it's a toxic chemical or if it's like citronella, I don't really know. But that's what we're building right here. I built one of these and showed it a couple times on a live video a month or so ago, and nobody said shit about it. There wasn't any, nobody seemed excited about it, so I just wasn't gonna build them. And then out of the blue, guys started asking about Thermacells, and I'm like, I'm not gonna build it. There wasn't any interest, and the guy's like, I'll take three, and other guy's like, I'll take two, and then all of a sudden people started asking for them, so. They're pre-order, I don't know how long we're gonna build them for, but I'm gonna show you how I build this. And this mesh is actually between two sheets of Cordura, two pieces. So I'm gonna show you how I do that also. How do we make this opening? Originally when I built this, I took the mesh, edge taped it, and that kind of looked shitty. Put it on the inside, and that kind of made a lip where it kind of stuttered. So I put it between the material, which some guys will have some problems, some difficulties with, but I'm gonna show you how I do it, or how I did this one. These, I made two of them yesterday, so this should go pretty smooth right now. I don't have a change of thread here, and I don't seem to have my scissors. I thought I had my scissors here. But we're gonna give this away, so I was gonna say I'm just gonna build it with brown thread, but I'll go get my scissors and thread. Okay, for the rest of the time that you're here today, I want you to lunge everywhere you go. Okay. Lunges, proper lunges.
Oh, I only do proper lunges.
Okay, we'll see. All right, we're gonna change this bobbin out. Here's how you're gonna change your thread, guys. And I'm only telling you this because I've seen people who didn't know this. Take your thread, cut it. Do not unlace the sewing machine. Take your other thread, keep it in the bag. If you don't have a bag, get a bag, put it in the bag. You can put it in a Ziploc, whatever. Set your thread here. Take this thread here that you cut long so you don't have to unlace this sewing machine. Tie this in right there. Do the same thing over here. Get you a cart or a shelf system. We use the wire racking shelves from Lowe's, Home Depot, Sam's Club, Costco. Sam's Club, Costco is the best place to buy them. You will save a lot of money buying them at Sam's Club or Costco. Okay, come here. I forgot to put this in here. I'm gonna put this in here. This one doesn't matter as much as the primary. This is your bobbin side. Take this thread, pull it through here. Be cognizant of where that knot is, so when it stutters, because if it catches, it will cut you to the bone when your finger slides across that thread. Cut this off. There is no reason to have to route this through here. When you are routing it through here, look here how it is. Comes down here through this hole, comes around this bobbin tensioner and back through this hole. You guys ever sewn and all of a sudden it's out of here? That's why. If you put it through here, that won't happen. Now, same thing here. If you're not aware, because I didn't know for 10 years probably because I had a machine that was broken. When you push your knee pedal, when you push that knee bar, it lifts this pedal. When it lifts that pedal, it also untensions your first tensioner right here, the tension piece that you screw down to add tension. When you push that, it releases the tension there, if it works, and then it comes through easily. A lot of times, guys, we'll have sewing machines where that little piece in there is just worn down and it doesn't release the tension. That's okay. Then you have to be able to find the hole. I can't find the hole. Now we're gonna change out that bottom bobbin. Let's show them this over here too. When you start sewing, this bobbin is empty. I'm going to take the thread out of that needle because when you run it, you can't have the thread in the needle there. I'm gonna run this, I'm gonna wrap this once, twice, three times. Take this thread and put it through one of these holes. Some bobbins have a slot, whatever, doesn't matter. I'm gonna hold about 3 or 4 inches away. I'm going to hold this thread here, the drive thread, I'm going to hold that so it doesn't unlace the machine. I'm gonna remove some tension. I'm gonna lift that leg lifter there to lift that foot, and I'm gonna start wrapping this. It's gonna wrap, and I'm holding this tight. I'm gonna let it go around about 20 times or so, which it has, and I'm just going to apply some pressure. It's gonna rip this thread off. I'm already wound. It's not gonna suck back in there and get twisted up. That's the way to lace this. I am always amazed, and I have had over 1,000 workers over the years. I am amazed how many people do not know how to do that. Now you know. We're gonna take this, run it through the needle. We're gonna run this down, and it's going to pick that bobbin thread up. That bobbin thread is now up here. I'm gonna lift this foot. I'm gonna use my scissors to wipe this back down. And I'm gonna hold this. I am always amazed how many people start sewing and they don't hold this, and you end up with literally a fucking rat nest right here that you have to cut out later or deal with. Same thing when you start sewing. Thread is very inexpensive. You have over a mile of it on this cone. Hold these tails. If you're not good at it, literally hold them in your hand when you start sewing. If you can, you can just press them down if you want to. Now we're gonna start sewing. Into video now, you gotta pay for the next one?
Yep.
All right. This is how I'm making this. I don't have any webbing that's 3.5 inches wide. I question if I'm even doing that the right way. Which one's which? Yeah, I'm doing it wrong here. So this one is the back piece. There's a back piece and a front piece. This is the back piece. I don't have any webbing that is 3.25 wide, so I'm making my back piece right here. What I'm doing here is finding center, the same way I make pals or a lot of other things on projects. I'm gonna hem this so that it's clean when I fold these all over. I'm gonna hem this. And I'm going to run, I need a hem here. I'm just gonna fold this over here. I'm not disconnecting it. The more you disconnect it, the more you gotta pull it out and start your sewing again. And I'm just gonna run this one right into here. Now I'll disconnect that. And now that piece is done as far as I'm gonna go right there. There's that. Here's these tails back here. I'm gonna hold them when I start sewing. I'm gonna take this right into the center here. We make a lot of products like this. Same way we would do the pals webbing. That just unlaced, it pulled out. Because I am actually caught around here, that's why it was sounding so weird. I've got this wrapped around one too many times. Different machines do different things. This one does this. And the problem with this is because I have that split foot on there. And I'm used to a foot that just has a hole in the middle of it.
I've been talking about it for a while now.
Yeah, I'll continue to. My sewing machine guy's coming. I'm gonna have him adjust this knee lifter and then put that other machine back together. And then we'll have those two other machines out in the podcast room in the studio. Okay, so I'm gonna start right here. I'm gonna sew right across there. And I'm lining this up right here on this line so it's nice and straight. And I'm gonna sew right down here. come across here. I'm gonna fold this in to meet it. And you can go down the center first if you want. I like to do it on the edges here. And I can hold this. I can hold this flat, and I can feel this right here. You'll feel if it's overlapped or if it's under, and you'll feel if it's perfect. And if it's perfect, I'm just gonna start sewing. And then I'm gonna adjust it again right here till it's perfect. And I'm pulling tension down and over. These will come out very, very flat. There will not be any pillow in these. It'll be like it's a flat piece of webbing that's woven when I'm done. Now I'm coming across to here, and I'm gonna run this straight down. And the way I'm gonna make this flat is I'm gonna push this out flat, and I'm only focusing on this side right here. And I basically got that yellow line that I'm just tracing. That's the line from when I cut it out. Just like so, and I'm gonna come two stitches over, one, two, and now I'm on the other side. And I'm pulling tension until it's where I want it to be. You can push it together, pull it apart so it's not overlapped. And now I've tacked that in. Now, you can do all kinds of bullshit with this. I have two raw edges right here that are sewn in. You can cover this with edge tape. You can cover it with webbing. You could even leave one side longer and sew it hemmed over. It doesn't need it. There's nothing sharp or rough going in this. This is just the back of this. There are no rough edges. There's nothing to cut this. This just has to slide in here, just like this. You can do whatever you want with yours. So there's that. I know that my Velcro is gonna go 3 inches. And I'm making this mark right here. And I'm going to make this mark 2 inches wide. I'm using 2-inch Velcro, so I'm gonna find the center right there. And I'm gonna come out 1 inch, and my mark's off my ruler there. So I'm gonna come out there 1 inch, okay. Now what this here is, so I'm gonna kick these in, and I'm gonna come from this point to this point. This is how I do my tourniquet pouches. This is how I do my cell phone pouches, anything that is gonna come in at an angle. And all I'm doing right here is tacking this down so that it stays in place. And I'm going to travel it back up on the other edge right here, and that's it. You can leave your square. I want this more finished appearance here. There is no functional reason that you have to flip this in here. It won't matter if these are just out there. It won't make any difference. There's 1,000 companies that make their shit all rectangle and square. A lot of my products even are. The most difficult thing for unskilled employee or an employee learning is probably that part of the process right there. So I'm gonna bring that in there also, and I'm just gonna tack that in. And I'm gonna bring it right up here to the corner. Needle strike down. When you make your turn, your needle is down and just starting to come up. That's where you can turn and not disconnect that stitch underneath. Not lose or jump that stitch. That's, if you're having problems where you're turning your corners and you're unstitched and you miss the corner, all the way down, just barely starting to come up, that's when you wanna make that turn. Again, tacked in at the start and stop. That's what we're after right there. This pull tab, I have this right here, and I don't want this pull tab on top. I want this pull tab to follow underneath and then have the Velcro cover it so that when I pull it, it pulls even and it doesn't try to rip the Velcro. It tries to actually pull that up. That's why I've done that way. Right here, I'm going to just set this right in place here. And I'm going to sew it right in, right here. This is a 6-inch piece of webbing. Just like that. Learn to clean this shit as you go. If you enjoy building stuff and you like sewing and getting this done, if you clean it as you go, you don't have a ton of cleanup at the end. That'll be the part you like the least, is the cleanup. I'm gonna go ahead and put this on here. That's why it's 2 inches, because it comes in right at 2 inches with this Velcro. That's just for aesthetics. There's no functional reason for doing that. Sew down the middle of the Velcro if you want to. I've seen companies that sew down the middle of their 1-inch Velcro. I don't ever sew down the middle of 1-inch Velcro. I'll sew down the middle of 1.5 inch and 2 inch, depending on what it is. There's that. Now I'm going to fold this same back here. Now, if you're not good at this, you might want to do your build a little different, maybe put it on top. I'm going through 2 layers here, 2 layers here. I have 4 layers of Cordura, so I've got 8 layers I'm going through, in addition to the Velcro, which is 9 layers. So if you're not really comfortable with your machine, you might want to start your needle strike in the center, so that when your needle goes down, you're in the center. Because if you're coming up on this 2 edges here, this 2 layers, it might push it and shift it. If you do it in the center, sew forward, and then slowly, intentionally sew backwards, and then back forward, and then back again. Now it's tacked in properly, it's not ever coming out, and you didn't shift it, and you didn't deflect and break a needle. Everything you did was intentional there. If you got a servo motor, which almost all of you will nowadays, turn your motor down until you're comfortable with the speed. So if you give it all the gas, it only has so much power that it can run. Okay, there's that. This is the bottom and the back. Well, it's the back and the top and lid of this, right? The bottom and as towards the bottom. So I'm gonna come from the bottom. I'm gonna put my pals on right here, 1.5 inches up from the bottom, just because that's what this pouch is, because I have one here, I know where it goes. So I'm gonna start right here. And you can make a mark 1.5 inches from this side and this side if you're not really comfortable with this, but I've done this a billion times, and I know that I can eyeball that and it's fucking perfect. I know that also this line is on center. If you're not really comfortable, you might want to actually measure and see where your center is. I know that mine is perfect, so I'm just going to start this right here, and I'm going to put my pals on right here. I'm going to go. There's 3 lines. There's 3 lines. I'm gonna use this one as a spacer, as my gauge to skip. There we go. Same thing here. We're just gonna go 1, 2, 3. And the only reason we're sewing between the two here is because it's easier than cutting it to travel. We're just gonna sew right into the next one. I'm gonna hold it right where I need it to be. I would normally use a gauge. I don't have a piece of 1-inch webbing out here. There's 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. There we go. I'm gonna do the same thing this way. You might want to do them all in the same direction, meaning sew the next one in the same direction. I always have a hard time sewing for some reason. I don't know why. You can do it however. Just make sure that you're holding it where it's straight so that it doesn't shift. So I'm going to needle strike kind of in the middle here. We're also going to sew a piece to the front, which is going to put more lines of stitching, so you really don't have to do those outers 3 times. There we go. I'm gonna shave these off. Can you zoom in on this webbing? You guys can see the grains in here, right? So there's literally lines through here. I'm gonna go about 2 grains. You can feel it click. 1, 2, you can't hear it. Sometimes you can. And I'm just gonna shave this. I'm gonna cut this right off of here. You can use a hot knife. You can use whatever you want to do it. I'm just cutting it with scissors and I'm gonna burn it from right here and I'm gonna sear these edges really well. And I'm just gonna go right across it with my lighter. It's gonna make a nice seal. It's gonna put a nice scab on that. There we go. Now, this is the tricky part. Not really. But I know that I'm gonna fold this over 1 inch, so I'm gonna bring it in. I'm gonna run the quarterator right there. So I'm making my mark at 1, right there. I'm gonna sew this right here. Now there's a couple ways you can do this. This folds over, and the reason this folds over is it's to cover this. I don't want edge tape where it'll stutter pulling it in and out because I want the pocket tighter right there. And I want that top to be 3 layers instead of 2 layers, which makes it a little more rigid, holds its shape so that the pouch stays open, putting the thing in and out, putting the Thermacell. So that's that. And I know that that's where that goes. And I know that I want my edge of this window right here to be, says 4 3/4. And that's what we're gonna put that at. So we're gonna go from this edge go 4 3/4 right here. And is this perpendicular? There is my perpendicular. So I'm just gonna run, this is the inside, and this is the outside. I'm gonna go ahead and, because I need these to line up when I make this cut. I need these to be the same rectangles. So there's that. What did we say, 4 3/4?
Yep.
Right there. Right there. I'm gonna go ahead and find the center, 7, so 3.5 is my center. And I know that this is going to be 2 inches. So I'm gonna go ahead and make my mark here, 7, so 3.5. And this window, I think this is 3. Yeah, 3, okay. So 1.5 both directions. There. Same thing here. 2 inches, 2 inches. Connect the dots. 7 inches. The center is 3.5. Right there. 1.5 inches each direction to make it 3 inches. There we go. That's it. These are gonna mark, these are gonna made up. Now, hopefully they don't look like they actually meet up, but we're gonna make them meet up. So from here, I'm going to literally just cut corner to corner, corner to corner, making an X. I'm gonna dive that razor blade in there, open that up, and I'm gonna bring this right into this corner. And I'm doing this with the scissors because I have a lot more control with the scissors than I do with that razor blade if it, once it starts to give and it just slides and cuts through. Find you a bunch of scissors, buy one of each pair wherever you buy them at, and try them out. You will have scissors that you like, you'll have scissors that you hate. And you might have a pair of scissors you think are great until you try a pair that's better. When you find a pair you really like, we've used these Westcott's right here. Westcott titanium nonstick. They used to come from Walmart. This, I bought 100 pairs or so of these things. The new ones, you buy the exact same thing off Amazon or you buy the exact same thing at Walmart, they are not the same anymore. Right during COVID, they must have changed shops or something and they got this hump here and my hand does not fit in here anymore. These ones are old. I can take this pair of scissors off. I can use it right here and I can set it down with the same hand. All the new ones, I cannot do that. I have to physically pull it off of my hands, even though the part number, everything's the same. So when you find a pair of scissors that you like, buy a bunch of them, put them away. They will change them. There's that, okay. Really, I'm doing contrasting thread, black on green. You're gonna see all of these stitch lines. You should really probably sew this in green first because it's more forgiving. I'm not going to take that advice and I'm just going to sew this in. Now, you can do it from either side. Because this is the side we are going to see, I am going to first do it from this side. It's definitely easier to do it the other direction. I'm going to come just one stitch past that line I have there. And I'm going to do the same thing over here. I'm going to fold this under. And we're looking at my line there to see what this is going to look like, because if you're even slightly off, which I am, I'm about half the pencil width off here. There we go. And I'm going to bring that out and move back closer to this line. Same thing right here. I'm gonna go ahead and cut this off and get this out of the way so we're not sewing over it or having to untangle it later. I'm lifting that foot up a little bit so that I've got room to get that material tucked under there. There's that. I'm gonna hit that same stitch line. I'm just gonna tack it in there. You could serge this, you could do all kinds of shit to seal that edge, whatever you want to do. I'm going to duplicate the same thing I just showed you right here on the other side. And you're going to find out if you're in line, if your eye was calibrated, and if it lines up in just a minute.
Do you think you were calibrated?
Oh, theirs won't be. Mine will be perfect. Even when it's not, nobody knows. Why is this the measurements for this? Because that's how I made it. Yours might be different. Okay. I already know that these are off a little bit, but we're gonna line them up, right? So we know that we want this 1 inch here and this hems over. So are these perfect? They're pretty fucking close to perfect. But we're gonna line them up so that they are perfect. And this might end up being 3/4. At the outcome, nobody's gonna know that that was different. Now, your mesh. We're gonna put this in here. Now, you could have sewn these all together. I did, some of these I built, I did this way. I took this, sewed this here, sewed it down and around, made my cut through both layers, cut them, and then fished them in, but it's very difficult to put this in there and get it. It's much easier to do them separate and put it in there. And I did not, this is longer than you need. You don't need it that big. Won't make any difference. But I'm gonna just trim it a little. Now, you can try to do this all at once, or you can try to, or you can, I'm not try, you can. Just sew around one of the frames, get all the wrinkles and creases out of it, sew it around, and then do the other side. I don't think I did one in this manner, but this seems like it'll probably be the way to do them production. And we're pulling in caddy corner, right? Always pulling caddy corner. That'll get it to lay flatter. There we go. Now, do you want to sew from the side you already sewed? Or do you want to sew from the other side? I don't know that it matters. The real question is, which side are you going to see the most of? And that answer is the outside. So I'm going to sew it from the outside, especially just because, really, because I'm doing contrast thread right here. Now, where this lines up perfect, you can see I'm off. I'm gonna go ahead and run it that way. That's the important part here for me, is that this line up. That's what I want. I can adjust the other on the fly here. I can make the hem a little smaller or larger. But this is the part you're gonna see, and especially because we're doing contrast thread, I wanna nail that same stitch line or very, very close to it. Go around it again. Just because if this comes out, if that were to come out of there, there's no warranty in this. You'd have to take the whole thing apart. It would be easier to replace it. So there's that. Now I'm going to run this down to the bottom. We're going to get this hemline here with no wrinkles. Run this. And then again, we're pulling over and catty corner. We're getting all the wrinkles out. And you can see there was some creep here. I've got 1 inch here, but 3/4 here. In the final product, you're not going to know it. So I'm going to level it up right here. No, I'm not, because I've already got that stitch. I'm going to go ahead and run it a little cockeyed. Now I'm going to tack that other one down. I wanted to sew it there so it looked good. If I'd have sewn it from the other side, that stitch would have creeped. Now I'm going to go ahead and tack this in. Disconnect, disconnect. Right there. Now I'm going to hem these edges in here. Very, very small. I want as much room in the pouch as I can get. Same thing here. The way we built this, you have 4 layers of material right here, and here you have 6 layers where that extra piece there is. And then on the sides, we have 4. So we're going through 8 layers of material putting this together, so be cognizant of that, plus the webbing. So this is 3 inches. This is actually 3 and closer to 3/4, but I'm going to go off this. I'm going to find the center here, 6. And I'm going to go 1.5 and 1.5. And that leaves us 1.5 inches here, and that means this mark here is going to be 1.5 inches. You don't have to make these marks. You can just fold it, but it's easier if you can see it from both sides. And here's what's going to happen. You could leave these tails inside, but it'll bump your product up. I'm going to sew this line to this line. You could have made your marks on the other side too if you wanted to. And I'm just sewing this way. I know you can't see it from the camera, but it's easier for me. This corner's flat. I'm going to sew right down this stitch line. Right there. And I'm going to remove this bulk. I'm going to come a little more than a quarter inch through there. You do what you're comfortable with until you get the hang of this. And I'm going to do the exact same thing right here. And if, hopefully your measurements are the same. You might want to measure twice before you cut that off. You can't change it at that point. Just because your girl's telling you you're too big, you might not want to have a couple inches cut off that thing because your next girlfriend might think you're too small. So. Is that a thing? That's not a thing.
I don't think it's a thing.
Who knows nowadays? All right, so there's that. That's what that looks like. I'm gonna flip that. That's what that looks like. I'm gonna take this. I'm gonna sew this center line on this center line. And I'm gonna travel right here. I'm gonna needle strike that right in the middle because the needle strike's not gonna make that move. I'm on here. I'm not coming up on here, right? I'm gonna shift. I'm gonna come right here to the edge. Turn this around and do the same thing this direction. There's a lot of ways to do this. You could pleat this. You could have left, that's probably what I should have done. I probably should have just left the bottom open altogether and ran a cradle of webbing like we do on some of our mag pouches. I don't know why I'm thinking that. I've actually built 5 or 6 of these before I got one that worked how I wanted. And really I should have just not done any of this bullshit. Should have just made a cradle. The build would have been way easier. All right, so, but then you wouldn't learn this. You wouldn't know this. So here, I'm just looking to where this looks right, how high I want this, and wherever this falls, the other side has to be the same. So I just don't want, do I want this pulled in and pulling the back up? No, I don't. I want it nice and flat. And you're gonna see that hem right there is traveling upwards, right? So I'm gonna sew that right there. So I'm gonna get this. What I'm looking for is what the bottom looks like. Does that look like I want it to look? Yes, I'm gonna come up here where I have some room. I'm gonna needle strike this. That locks it in and keeps everything from shifting. And now I'm gonna sew this in. I'm gonna get up right here. I'm gonna tack this in real well. Now I'm gonna travel all the way back down. I'm only sewn to here, right guys? I've got 2 inches, 3 inches open. I'm gonna get this on there, no shift. I'm gonna follow that line to there, and now I'm putting all this back in line where I want it. There. There we go. Where I'm telling you guys, always hold your thread. You don't have that rat nest. You don't have to fish that thread out of there. Here's an example of that right here. That was just, I don't know what that even was, but there it is. So you should cut that off before you burn it. If you burn it, you're gonna smear it and it's gonna leave some burnt thread. If you're gonna smear it in the direction of the other thread. It won't stand out as much. We're gonna do the exact same thing right here. Get it kind of level. But more importantly, is it the same on both sides? Because that's what's gonna catch. Yes, I sure did forget the Velcro. Which would have been way easier to put on before this. I'm going to line this up right here. Is it about the center of this window? Pretty close. I'm gonna tack this right here. And so far I've built all of these and there's no labels on any of them. So Monday morning, they're gonna ask me, where do you want a label on this?
I don't know.
I'm gonna go, shit, I don't know. No, you can't put it in the middle of the Velcro because then the Velcro, it kills the Velcro. Covers up the Velcro.
Very bottom?
Nah, we'll put it. I know where we'll put it. I'm gonna put it right here. Now we're gonna level this. So I would have sewn that all the way closed too had you not said something. I even had the Velcro sitting in front of me.
Yeah, I wasn't even thinking about it, and then I looked down and I was like,
what is that extra piece? That? There's always extra pieces. I took the dash out of my Ford Ranger once and I had a lot of extra pieces when I was done.
That's what zip ties are for.
That truck always rattled. I had taken it apart because they had this marine grade carpet that was like a short shag and had a foam backing on it. And I had adhered, I had spray adhered adhesive all over everything and then put the carpet in. And wherever it didn't lay flat, I'd cut it and then put another little piece in. So there was like a bunch of pieces. It looked great.
Yeah.
But all the dudes that saw it, they're like, how much to do this? Will you do it? And I'm like, man, this looks like shit. And I know that within 6 months of the summer, this is gonna start to unpeel and it's gonna look like shit. And I never did it for anybody. They're like, man, you should do custom car interiors and shit. And I didn't, that was before I even had a sewing machine. I wasn't doing any of this shit. And that shit never did unadhere because I guess because of the foam backing that was on the carpet, it came like from Home Depot. And then just 3M adhesive glue on both sides. And
just
then you
morphed it together.
Yeah. Ooh, I just came off. You really see it right there with the black thread. You can see where it shifted a little. So the way to handle that, clamp it down. So you, that's your third hand. And just pick these out, right? You can get one of these little screwdrivers. What you're looking for is promotional screwdriver. They used to give these away. I found them on Amazon. I just bought 100 of them. And you can sharpen it a little bit and that'll help pick these threads out. It's one stitch at a time. Now I'm gonna come back, do this again. Now there's three lines of stitching at the bottom. I don't even have to travel back down here at all. I'm gonna jump up a stitch so I can make that turn a little easier. Pay more attention this time. Even if I left it fucked up, it looks better than a lot of companies' best product looks. There we go. My needle is shifted. There we go. Go. Thermacell pouch. We will be giving this away next week. By the time you see this, somebody will already own it. Today, last week we built that vehicle med bag. And before we did this video right here, Friday, we're probably close to 5 o'clock right now. We did a live, we recorded members on YouTube question and answer. They ask me and Amanda questions about business or whatever, and we answer all those questions with as much valuable, with as much value and actionable information as we can provide. We take those pretty serious. And then we do the same thing for Patreon. We also built a Patreon video today. And then we do a live, and in the live, we stream to Twitter X, YouTube, Instagram, and Facebook. And whoever participates in that conversation gives the best questions, we give the best answers, whatever, whoever sticks out, we pick a winner. To be a winner, you have to be a member on our Patreon, and you have to have an order number. And we gave away that vehicle med bag to somebody on there, and we gave away an OD tool bag, or we tried to. I picked two or three dudes, they weren't winners, they weren't members, so we wouldn't give it to them, because you're going to communicate with us on Patreon in the chat section, and you have to have an order number, so we can simply put in your order number and print a shipping label to make it as seamless as possible to give free gear away. And amazingly, we picked three people who we didn't give the product to, but we did give the vehicle med bag. So next week, by the time you're seeing this video, this will have been given to somebody on one of those lives next Friday, or maybe Wednesday. We do it Wednesday also, Scully and I do. So there you go. This is on the website, Thermacell pouch. On the front page, the landing page, when you go to my website, SOE Tactical Gear, there's a search bar on the homepage. Every page you're on, if you go all the way to the top right on the phone, you might have to scroll over. There's also a search bar there. You can put in Thermacell. And if you're like, man, I don't want to pay $65 for that pouch, well, you don't have to. You can buy a $1,200 machine and $25 cones of thread and, you know, a couple $100 of material to get the pieces you need, and you can build your own pouch. So that's how it's built, right there. And we will see you guys next week. I built this thing from the bottom, they tore it down, I rebuilt it. I give-